All right, good morning again, everybody. Great to be with you today. How many of you noticed it's a fifth Sunday of the month, right? Fifth Sunday? Well, you know, normally there's four Sundays in a month, and every so often we get an extra Sunday. And on those extra Sundays, we want to do just something extra to show our appreciation and love for our church family. So after church today, we have something special for all of you. Don't be shy. Out in the foyer, we have little cafe samples, some brownie bites. So enjoy those today, just to let you know how much you are loved and appreciated and honored in this place. Amen. We love you guys. Hey, we're right in the middle of a series called Becoming Great Neighbors. Before we get into that, I want to let you know that in the next 2 weeks are some really important days here at Cornerstone Chapel. As you heard, some really cool things happening here. And tomorrow launches our church-wide 10 days of prayer and fasting. And last week I just reminded everybody to be preparing on how you'd participate in that. But hopefully by now you're just kind of sensing what the Lord's been sharing with you on maybe something to kind of lay aside for these 10 days and how we can better connect with God in these 10 days as a church. And as far as coming together corporately, I want to remind you that out in our foyer as well, we have these prayer guides that we always have available. Now, if you have one, these are the same ones that we always provide for you. But if you don't have one, pick one of these up. It's an amazing resource on prayer. And on the back, it has a schedule of when we are meeting corporately for prayer, or we have these handouts, you can grab one, or it's in your bulletin. But we want to make sure you know when we're gathering for these prayer times, because they're all kind of different. We have some morning times, and we have some evening times, and we have some off-campus times, and we'd love to just have a great army of prayer warriors meeting every time to just seek the Lord on what he's doing in our church family. So, like I said, right in the middle of a series called Becoming Great Neighbors, And speaking of becoming a great neighbor, we have a special treat today. We have some very dear friends of ours here, Pastors Bill and Harriet Maurer from Amherst, and they brought with them just a wonderful friend of our Foursquare family, our denomination, Pastor Mary Bennett. And how many of you know there's power in someone's story, right? Well, we are very blessed today to just be able to hear an amazing story of this great woman of God and how she, her whole life just exudes being a great neighbor to all those that Jesus has brought into her life. So we're going to hear that today. And it's just great to have the Maurers with us today. And Deb and I love you guys so much, and we're so honored to have those few years in our life that we were able to serve together in Amherst. So, hey, Cornerstone, can we just give a huge Medina welcome? Come on for Harriet Maurer and Mary Bennett.
You always have to escort before we.
It's so true. Calvin is Mary's son, and his wife said to him one time, "When your husband treats you like a princess, it must be because he had a queen as a mother." Isn't that sweet? Well, today's about legacy, and we love being here, and I want to say our gratitude to you, Pastor Mark and Debbie. We had our eyes on them long before they came to be with us, and then as God willed it, we spent that time together. And as I mentioned to you, I was talking with a gal just this past week who reminded me of a message she had heard that you preached. So that's something about the word of the Lord that comes through a life of character that Pastor Mark has, and you are blessed to have both of them. I know you know that. And we love being here. Thank you for this invitation today. Well, again, today is about legacy. And Mary, you are leaving a legacy before right now. You've lived a legacy. And I really believe that you leave a legacy because you live a legacy. And we're going to discover some things. So I'm going to begin by bragging on her, because she will not brag on herself. And that is this, that Mary was born and raised in Line Fork, Kentucky, and then had a few years away from Kentucky, and then God pushed her back, literally, to Kentucky, the hills of Kentucky again. And so she'll be sharing some of that. But she has a home now for children. It's called Sunshine Children's Center. Has fostered over 120 children. In fact, as a single mom plus being a pastor, I mean, what's the big deal, right? And so over 120 children that the state of Kentucky honored her as the foster mom of the year two times, which is incredible. Another award is called the Kentucky Colonel Award. Well, when you think of Kentucky and you think of Colonel, you think of chicken. But it's not. It's not about chicken. It's about honoring people who have had the grace, the dividends, whatever, to give to humanity as a humanitarian award. And they gave this to her as the whole state and honored her. Now, just to show you what kind of company she's in with that award, Ronald Reagan was also honored the same award another year. So when you think of the distinction, Mary, that God has given to you through our government and through our state, it's amazing. Foursquare has also honored her. If you'll go on YouTube, you can do the Power of One Mary Bennett YouTube. The Power of One. They had 1 year, a whole investment into one person and to see what power they have. Mary was featured. It's a 4-minute video. If you can't find it there, go to foursquare.org and you'll see it there. So I lovingly call this lady the Mother Teresa of Foursquare. So she has all the children. She's adopted 17 of them and is currently, she's only 39, you know. Currently adopting a 2-year-old. Is that amazing? So Mary, let's begin with your story, and we're going to chat a little bit about it today. I would like for you to tell about your childhood with your mom and dad growing up.
Well, excuse me. My dad was just a poor boy that came into Lime Fork looking for work, and he married my mother, who was 14. He was 17. And they literally had to walk through the stream of water, which is called Lime Fork Creek, to get out of there, and because there was no road. And they went over a mountain into a community called Lynch, Kentucky. It was called Lynch because they lynched people there and tarred and feathered them. But Mom rented, as a teenager, she rented a boarding house with approximately 10 bedrooms in it, and she rented these rooms out to coal miners from all over the world that was there to work and send money back to their country, their families. They made approximately $5 a week, and they gave her $1 a week to stay there and get 3 meals a day and a bed to sleep in. When she saved up $400, she went back to Lime Fork and bought 400 acres of land and a house. She had already lost one baby as a teenage bride because it starved to death. Her milk couldn't, it was allergic to milk, and they took it from mother to mother to mother, and no mother had the right milk, so she just literally starved. And my mother there's 16 of us all together, and I was number 13. I believe. So many. But my mother and dad took in at least 100 relatives that were too poor to provide for their children. So they would bring their children there and drop them off. And it was always hard because we just lived in one room. And 5 slept in a bed. Everybody else slept in the floor. And there was a potbelly stove in the middle to keep us warm. And then across the yard was a kitchen. We called it our kitchen, but it was just a little shack, one room. And that's where we had our meals.
So tell us about the behavior of your dad, what you grew up with.
Well, Mom said he wasn't always mean, but he was mean all my life. I know that. But He was violent. He was cruel. He was rude. He drank heavy. I don't know that he missed a day. He wasn't drunk on moonshine or something. And he abusive, very abusive to our mother. He would beat her with his what they call a mining belt, which is a very thick strap. He would beat us. He broke bones of some of my brothers, which they never got set because there's no way to go to a doctor. Just a bad enough man to have been shot if somebody had shot him. It would have been probably no loss, but my mother loved him, and no matter what he did, she'd always say, "He's your daddy. Don't talk about him. He's your daddy." And he would bring other women into the home and make her feed them and feed her woman's family and say, so she could take food home to them. And let me tell about the one time. He'd done this so many times that when I saw him coming with the woman, I would just naturally start shaking. Because usually after the woman left, we'd all get beaten real bad. And so this day I saw him coming down the road. We had a dirt road by then. And he had a woman with him. And I was literally shaking all over. And I looked out of the corner of my eye and I saw my mother standing at the edge of the yard. And she always wore apron, so she had her hands in her pocket, like she always stood. And he came up the steps with this woman, and he said, "Go get this woman some food. Her and her children are hungry. You go get her some beans and peaches, and be sure and get her some canned tomatoes because she can make soup." And Mom didn't move, and I was screaming inside, "Go, Mom, go. Do what he tells you to do." And he hollered at her again and said, "Go get this woman some food, I told you." And she wouldn't move. And then he said it another time or two. And Mom pulled out her hand out of the pocket of her apron, and it had a pistol in it. And she said, "You're not getting a bite of food that I've prepared for my children. And if you try to take it, I'll kill both of you." And the last time I saw the woman, she was running at high speed down the road. And my dad stumbled in the house and fell passed out at the door. But I thought surely we'd die when he woke up because he was violently mean. And but he never brought it up. And I always felt after that that she bluffed him. He didn't know if she still had that gun or not. And so...
There's an experience that your mother had. You talked about her going to the top of the mountain to just get away. And what happened to your mom while she was up there?
Well, let me introduce it with a night problem. One night I heard my dad beating my mom. I was sleeping up in the attic, and they had a bedroom down at the bottom of the steps. And I decided to kill him. So I loaded the shotgun that I had up there and was creeping down the steps to kill him. And I fell, stumbled, and the gun fell all the way to the bottom. Zoop, dump, dump, dump. And I knew that he knew what a gun was when he heard it hit the floor. He got real silent. And he had beat her so bad, and he was hollering at her to... "What did you do? What did you do?" And she kept saying, "I didn't do anything." And the next morning I asked her, "What did you do? What were you saying that over and over?" And she said, "Well, he was beating me in the head with his fist. And all of a sudden, he hit a plate of glass." And he was hollering at her, "What did you do? Where did you get the glass?" And she went up into the mountains and she told God, "I can't take no more." And to make a long story short, she came out talking in tongues. She didn't know what she had. We didn't know what she had. Dad thought she had the devil, so he was running from her. And Mom was following him, talking in tongues, and we were following Mom, listening, trying to make sure she's all right. So that was our first experience of unknown language.
But when he said, "Where did you get the glass?" as he was hitting her, he couldn't get to her face. her face and her head was just covered with this clear piece of glass that he thought was amazing. So during your childhood, you came to know Jesus, and there was a blind man that would come to your home, and that your mom had confidence in him, that he was a good man, and invited you to his home one day, particularly to do a task for him. So would you share with us about that part, Mary?
Well, he was always telling me not to say I hated my dad. I would tell him every time I'd lead him around the farm, we'd talk. And I'd tell him how bad I hated my dad, and he'd say, don't talk about that. It's wrong. You ask God to forgive you right now. You can't hate people. So I wouldn't tell him no more, and one day he wanted me to come to his house. He said he'd had a vision the night before, and he wanted me to write it down. And it was about a mountain girl that was going to leave home, and she was going to get educated, but she also was going to have a heartbreak. A very, very bad heartbreak. And she was going to come back into the mountains. And it just went on and on. And when I found out it wasn't about my sister, who was 15 and had left home with $10 in her pocket, and she said, I'm going to California. Well, I didn't know where California was, and I'm sure she didn't either. And so I worried about her. And he said, no, it's not your sister, but I can't tell you who it's about. So if you ever need these papers, my family will give them to you. And I needed to get out of the mountains because my dad said we had to leave home at 18. So I started wondering how I was going to get out of the mountains. I was the last to leave home. And we had no cars. We had no way to communicate with people, no phones. So I was really desperate. Where would I go? And a girl came into town, and she told me I could join the Air Force. So I joined the Air Force thinking she was going to join with me, but she never showed up. And I didn't know how to pass the test, so the recruiter said, if you'll just leave those papers on the table and leave, I will fill them out for you. So I got into the Air Force.
And that's how she joined the Air Force. The interesting thing, Mary, was when you also got to another place of entry point, they had to weigh her. You had to weigh at least 100 pounds. And she said, how much do you weigh? And she would always respond,
79 pounds, ma'am. And she'd say, get back on those scales and weigh yourself again.
And she said, how much do you weigh?
79 pounds, ma'am.
So she just let her by. So she was just this, didn't know how to fill it out. But in the military, and I'm going to jump you ahead a little bit, okay? In the military, they discovered the incredible intellect of this woman. Mm-hmm. And when you hear about the entrepreneurial skills that she has had, it's just incredible. So she joined the Air Force, went to Texas, hoping she would find a cowboy in Texas. And that's what they told her, you'll find a cowboy there. Then went to Seattle, Washington, and then from Washington went to L.A. While in L.A., she met a Hispanic girl who was going to Life Bible College. And she said, Mary, you should go to Life Bible College. And she did. Graduated from there. Then began working at AT&T. She did so well at AT&T that they kept promoting her and promoting her. And as a result, when God just kept pressing you through Glenn Burris's father, who was at that time the supervisors, I need you, Mary. I need you to plant a church in Kentucky. And with tears streaming down his face, Glenn Burris's dad said, please come back, please come back. She said to God, I'll give you 1 year, that's all. AT&T said, we'll save your spot for 2 years, just in case it's longer, because we want you back. Well, she ended up back in, of all places, Line Fork, Kentucky. So we're going to fast forward to Line Fork now as a pastor. So accepted in the South as a woman, we know that, And some really interesting experiences. One of them you have to hear, and that's with the windows were open to the church, and I'll let Mary take it from there.
Well, everybody that came to church brought their gun. And everybody that came to church had tobacco, men and women. And they would spit out the windows the whole service. Just one right after another would go and spit out the window.
Men and women.
Men and women. And if they hit the window, that was fine. If they didn't, that was fine. And we had a water bucket in the back of the church that had one dipper, and everybody would be going back and forth to get some water. Or they'd stand in the door of the church and smoke and blow it back in the church, just anything to aggravate me. And I told them it was wrong, that they couldn't spit no more. So they said, well, the spirit just right out of the church, just right out the windows. We can't come here if the spirit can't move. And we can't have a spirit if we can't chew tobacco. So they got their cans at home of beans or peas or corn, and they brought them to spit in. So all during the sermon, I had to watch them spit in that can. And they really make noise when they spit. So I just hated dealing with them. I told God, let them go to hell. I mean, what else can you do with people that's ignorant? And he had told me back in California, I kept begging him not to send me back, and he showed me a vision of a mountain. And the mountain was just as high in the sky as you could see without any trees on it. And I had told him 1,000 times, Lord, those mountain people smother me to death with their religion and their incest, their wife beating, their child abuse, and all of these things. And you're wanting me to go back there and tell them that they're going to heaven, or get them to go to heaven, and I'm going to hell because I'm going through a divorce, you know. So I thought I had to go to hell because of that. I don't know who told me that, but the devil sure did. And so I was dealing with that and going to Bible college every day trying to find out what hell was like, because I didn't need to know about heaven. I need to know where I was going. And they would never say nothing about hell much. But in that vision of that mountain, there was a multitude of people at the top. And there was only one staircase down the mountain, and it had no handrail. And I was begging the people. I was in the center, and I was begging them, move back, move back. You're crushing me. I can't breathe. Move back. And they wouldn't move back, so I shoved them and shoved them. And 3 fell off the mountain forever and ever and ever they fell. And I looked up to heaven and I said, Father, what do you want me to do? And he said, go over to the staircase, stand at the top, and get each person by the hand and put them on the top step. If you'll put them on the top step and get them started down the mountain, I'll take them the rest of the way. And as I put each one on the top step, they ran and skipped down the mountain, singing and laughing and cheering. And when they got all to the bottom, it was just a roar coming up from the valley, just a huge roar of happiness and joy. And I was alone on the mountain. And I said, God, what is it you want me to do? And he said, I want you to go back to Limeford, Kentucky, and open up a church. My mother prayed every day in that cellar, in the same cellar Dad kept his moonshine and his homebrew. And she wanted a church for her children. And in her lifetime, she didn't see it. But as time went on, he said, and when the people start crushing you with their beliefs and smothering you, you just remember I put you there for one reason, and that's to show them how to go to heaven, point them to heaven, and I'll take them the rest of the way.
Isn't that great? Point them to heaven, and I'll take them the rest of the way. Mm-hmm. Well, one particular Sunday, as the windows were open on your church, a copperhead came through one of the windows.
Well, I knew everybody in church had a gun. And I figured if they saw a snake, they'd all shoot it one time. And I was up there, so I didn't want it to shoot toward me. And there was hardly a Sunday that we didn't kill snakes as we went out of the church. So everybody was wise. They carried a gun. And so as that snake come crawling through the window, it came right at me. So I waited till it got close enough, and I slammed down a hymn book on top of it and then jumped on it to crush it, squish it. And I was jumping up and down. Well, everybody in church started jumping up and down because they thought the spirit was on me. And they let the spirit get on them. And I showed him the snake, and the church just emptied. There was nobody there.
Such experience, different pastoral experiences, Pastor Mark, that Mary has had. Well, I'm going to ask her to share another story, and that's about Joey. When Joey, people started asking her to take their babies, and so Joey's story is pretty amazing. Would you share that with us, please?
Well, his mother was from Ohio, and she came to Kentucky. And she was, she got pregnant, and she wanted me to, she wanted everybody to know she would give $1 million if she wasn't going to have that baby. And I didn't understand. I just say, you shouldn't say that. That baby might can hear you. She says, well, I don't care. I don't want this baby. So when it was born, she brought it to me and said, will you keep the baby just 2 days? I'm just so nervous, I just want to go away and rest. Well, she had been taking drugs, so the baby had drugs, and he was biracial, and that was why she didn't want him. And so the church people told me that if I kept him, my ministry was ruined. And it really didn't bother me that much about it because I thought, well, I didn't want to stay here anyway. I'd just like to go back to California where people are civilized. But, you know, you can't hardly hold a baby unless you get bonded to it. Have you noticed that? The minute you feel that skin, you just want to stay there. So I carried this baby on my shoulder to cook and to clean and to can my vegetables and to preach my sermons. When he fell asleep in my arms, I'd put him at my feet and put my feet on him so he could feel me. Very insecure baby. He cried if I even tempted to move him out of my arms. And I'd sleep at night in a chair with him on my shoulder, and I would sing to him and talk to God about the misfortune of being stuck with a baby that nobody wanted. And how was I going to do it? I didn't have money. I didn't have the time. But I'd tell him in over and over thousands of times, as I did my other children along the way, you're smart. You're a star. You just need to knock out some clouds so people can see you shine. Or, you know, you're bright. You're a genius. Just there's just no limit what you can do. And so as he was growing up, he became he proved he was very intelligent. The devil tried many times, and in the book you'll read many times he tried to kill this baby. And I was even told he was going to be kidnapped, and I lived in a lot of fear. But I told God, I've bonded with him. He's bonded with me. If I go away, he'll have nobody. The other children won't have nobody. So I don't care if he's purple. I'm going to keep him. And God told me, well, get up and build that home I told you to build. And I promise you, you won't have to spend your time praying for money or praying for food. I spent a lot of time praying for money and food because sometimes we were completely out of food. And I would not. I tell God, if you make me go to the food stamp office and ask for food stamps, then you take all these kids back. I'm not going to do it. God is bigger than that. And I'm an advocate for anyone who needs them. Go get them. We pay for them, you get them. But not me. I was a little bit proud, and I didn't want to do it. And he provided over and over enough to feed dozens of children every day.
And because God told her at one point, don't let a penny stay in your fingers, you just keep giving it. And in turn now, God has provided large semi-trucks of food brought in into big freezers, and she literally feeds the valley and beyond. And so it's not only for the children. We have a video of Joey she was talking about, who now is he works at a nuclear power plant, has an amazing job. He sent a video for you to see.
Hey, Mom. I wanted to take a moment to say thank you for instilling in me the value of persistence, dedication, commitment, and hard work. Over the course of my working career, extending from my teens until now, I have consistently seen that working diligently and with a good attitude will take you further than intelligence or natural talent alone. Applying what I've learned from you, I have been blessed with success in all my pursuits. Either I've been provided with leadership opportunities or I've been given accolades to both praise and reinforce my work ethic. While I was growing up, I have many not so fond memories of waking up at 5 a.m. to mop the floors and vacuum the carpet. At the time, I simply saw the completion of the task as the end goal. However, now as an adult, I see you had a different purpose in mind. You were instilling discipline and character. You taught me that it's not the task that's important or simply getting it done. It's how the person accepts the responsibility, the dedication with which they work, and how they do so to the best of their ability. And for those lessons, Mom, I'm truly thankful. I love you so much.
He's one of 17 adopted and one of over 120 who call her mom. I want to sneak this little story in. When Paul was very young, her children found him out by the railroad tracks, brought him in. She had some food in front of him, and he cried when he saw the food, and he was just, you know, longing for it. And Paul still lives with her because of mental disabilities. He's now 40-some, I believe, 43. And guess what? When he came in, when he was that little boy, she said, Paul eats first. Paul still eats first. There was a time when you had $10 to your name, a bread truck pulled up, and a guy came in, wanted to sell you bread. What happened?
Well, I was saving my $10 for emergency because I had no way of getting any more. So he wanted to sell me some bread for 43 cents a loaf. And I told him I didn't need any. And he stayed a while and talked. And then he said, let me sell you some bread. And I said, no, I don't need any. I didn't have a single item in the freezer. It was completely empty. But I needed that $10. And he's just right out of the blue, he said, well, I'll sell you the whole truckload for $10. And I let him bring it in, and he filled my freezer to the top with bread. But I was angry. I was angry at him that he took my last penny. But that night we got 36 inches of snow. And I'd had approximately 80 chickens that roosted in trees out on the hillside. And they couldn't get down because of the snow, so they'd just drop their eggs in the snow. And I'd go out and dig out the eggs until I couldn't stand it no longer and take them in and thaw out and then come back and dig out some more eggs. So for weeks, we had eggs and toast, toast and eggs, scrambled eggs and toast. We even discovered if you tear out a hole in the middle of the bread and put an egg in there, it tastes really good.
It's just amazing. I love that story. But she would come in, her legs would be frozen, and the children would massage your legs, you said, and care for her. Right now, Sunshine Children's Center has a beautiful, large log cabin home. There's also a church on the campus right beside Lion Fort Creek. There's a guest house, and there's an apartment. Buses International has been down there many times. They've put in a basketball court for the children.
Bunkhouse.
And a bunkhouse, that's right.
It sleeps 30.
Sleeps 30 people for all the teams that come in. And Melanie was there when she was a teenager.
20 years ago. I said 30 this morning. Sometimes I make mistakes.
And it's great. So your church has already been there, and maybe we'll go again, because there are always things that need to be done down there. With all the evaluations and the insurance forms and whatever filled out, to this day, no penny is owed on any mortgage, and it is valued at almost $3 million. Really amazing. Well, just a couple of days ago, her son Calvin called. Calvin lives in Chesapeake, Virginia, near Virginia Beach, and she brags on him constantly. Calvin came with her as a very young boy with his siblings, and he's going to tell you a little bit about that story because we had a video of him. But a few days ago, he said, I can get a flight. I want to come up. And so we have Calvin with us today. And as he comes, come ahead, Calvin. I want to tell you that Calvin now, he's been a youth pastor. God's done such a great thing in his life. But he owns his own business in Virginia Beach. And he has the name of it is?
Sunshine. Calvin is that cussing cowboy I always wanted to have. How he came to me cussing like John Wayne.
But Calvin, I don't remember that, but I get told that all the time. So
Calvin wouldn't say this either, but he has a business that restores bathrooms and kitchens and countertops and all. And is how many people working for you now?
Anywhere from 6 to 8. People.
Isn't that amazing? 6 to 8 people working for him at this very profitable business. So would you please welcome Mary's son, Calvin.
Well, I'm not sure how I turned into a business owner because she wouldn't let me have a screwdriver growing up. She said I was a dangerous boy with a screwdriver because all the doors would be off their hinges and anything I could take apart, I would. And sometimes it wouldn't get put back together, but I'm better now, just in case you're wondering. But mom is someone who is full of humor. I mean, it comes out when she just can't help it. But she's also someone who has experienced a lot of pain, pain that she's never even told us about or anyone else about, but I know that it's there, but for whatever reason hasn't fully disclosed it all. And it's amazing to see the lives that she has changed. I came to live there at 6 years old.
You was younger.
Well, my brain is 30, and hers has a little more age. I'm pretty sure I was 6. Four. Maybe I acted like a 4-year-old. I don't know. But I came to live there at 6 years old. I was in and out of foster care. So I'd moved 7 times, and on the 7th time, lucky 7, I came to know Mary Bennett. And initially, I... Coming in, I didn't want to go there because it didn't have the traditional family. It wasn't a mom and a dad. And I was very clingy, had issues, very insecure, had to have a hug every 5 minutes. Once I got there, I realized that God was giving me everything that I had asked for. Maybe not the way that I wanted it, but he did give me a mother and then a father. But it wasn't the father that I thought I wanted. It was that I thought I needed. It was Abba Father. And for someone who didn't have that father figure in her life ever, for her to have managed to work through who Daddy God is and then be able to teach it to us is amazing. And so it's been such a trip. Just being mom's son, and my life is just so, where I am now compared to where I would have been is just amazing. And, I would come in and we would have a new person coming in the house, a new kid, a 5-year-old or a 6-year-old or a 10-year-old, all ages. But they would come in and typically they'd come in with a garbage bag or a ratty container of their stuff, and it was dirty, just too small, worn out, and she would always go through it. She would never discount what they had. She would always go through it and then kindly say, hey, let me take you upstairs. And so she would take that person upstairs to a dresser that would have new clothes, new toys. And I grew up seeing those things, and it taught me. That's how I was introduced to who God is. It wasn't from, hey, son, let me tell you about God. It was, let me show you what he would do if he were here. And, that picture of her taking that person upstairs and saying, hey, let me show you what I've got for you. I've got it just for you. What a picture of what God does for us because we do. We come to him with nothing really to offer. We come with our filthy rags. Our righteousness, as the best we have, is as filthy rags. And what a picture of God coming into our life and saying, hey, I've got something for you. And really, at its core, that's what sunshine is. It's taking every opportunity that we can to take someone who is in a less fortunate position, whether that's feeding the community. And we literally have, I don't know, maybe 15 freezers that fill up and empty just as quick as we can get them. We have truckloads of food and things that come in. We have teams that come in, I would say anywhere from 300 to 400 groups or teams, individuals come every summer, and just they come, they bring their youth, they'll do a retreat, and then they get to experience part of that. Hey, let's go to so-and-so's house. One team, Durant's team actually, just restored a woman's home, and literally it was just dirt floors and completely unlivable, unsafe living area. And we like to think those things don't exist anymore, but they do. They're all around us. And one of the things that Mom has done so well is not only has she adopted and actually physically touched kids, but she's also spiritually adopted as many as I can think of, kids that other people who have helped, or kids that she has seen, wow, I'm not in a position to adopt you, to foster you, but let me walk through your life with you. And one of those kids is in Albania right now, serving. She was adopted. And Mom's walked with her all through her life, through graduation, through college, birthdays. And she's in Albania now, helping with some, interacting with kids there, and then doing some stuff with the Syrian refugees. And some of the stories that come back as a result of the work of Mary Bennett and the work of Sunshine, it's just amazing. And, you know, that power of one, the power of one person. And I like to think of Jesus kind of as the divine orphan. He was, if anyone was orphaned, it was Jesus. You know, he looked to his father and said, Father, if you can take this cup from me, please do. Because he knew that once he drank that cup, he was orphaned from the only father that he ever knew. And what a picture that is of Jesus coming and saying, hey, if I can help point the rest of humanity to the divine and point them in that direction of salvation, then I bet that all of you guys, all of us, can do it as well. Because we all experience those orphan moments in life that maybe you weren't orphaned, but we experience those orphaned moments all the time. You know, you lose a loved one, you're orphaned. Maybe someone doesn't treat you the way you would like to be treated. You feel rejected. That's an orphan moment. And Jesus, in those moments, he challenges us to say, it's not about you, you know? And as a little kid, as an outsider walking into her home, you'd be like, man, that woman, she's telling those kids that? Like, she would tell us, hey, it's not about you, you know? Like, yeah, the pain is deep. It's rough, but it's not about you, and you've got to forgive. And, you know, those are conversations that we would think, oh, you know, when you get a little older, we'll really dig into this. But no, little kids that just, you know, it breaks your heart to say, hey, the doctor just told me that you might not be able to have children because of the abuse that took place. And for her to walk a little girl, through those moments, that's living on purpose. And we can all do that. You know, we all look to do something that's just powerful, great, especially we as Americans. It's all about the American dream or influence, you know. How many followers can I get on Instagram? How many likes can I get on Facebook? And we quantify our worth over those things. And it's just, there's a better way to do it. And, you know, I once heard said, if you want to change the world, change your world. And God puts the people around us, those divine appointments, and he does it on purpose. And we look for the big things to do, but sometimes it's the little things, and sometimes it's the very hard, difficult things to say, I see you. We've all seen the homeless man, right? And what do? We tend to back off a little bit. But there are so many of those moments, those orphan moments in our life that we can capitalize on. And if we don't capitalize on them and we just brush over it, our destiny is attached to the way that we respond to those orphaned moments. And so I just want to challenge, you know, all of you guys and myself. It's a never-ending process to take advantage of those orphaned moments, because your pain has a purpose. My pain has a purpose. There is nothing that has happened to you that God cannot use. And to the depth of the pain, he can invert that and multiply it indefinitely in the opposite direction. And you're looking at it right here. You're looking at it because it's a woman who has been abused, has had a hard life, but she didn't focus on herself. She focused on the others around her that she could make a difference in.